искусственного интеллекта развивается очень быстро и предоставляет новые
The field of artificial intelligence is developing very fast, and how the artificial intelligence can impact on all of us and what kind of opportunities we have in this field, it will be spoken by Gawdat, best-selling author of Soul for Happy. He is a former chief business officer of Google X and host of Slow Mo.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Apologies for this technical difficulty. I was told that I need to repeat my wonderful introduction, and I'm very, very happy to do that. So again, big welcome to the third Central Asian Nobel Fest. And we are absolutely lucky today to have with us Mr. Gawdat, who will talk to us on smart, he will talk to us about the scary smart, the future of artificial intelligence, and how you can save our world. A very interesting topic indeed, because as we all know, artificial intelligence is developing fast as a technology, and it is probably one of the very few things in the world that would impact in future every single citizen of our planet. And of course, how you can contribute, how you can make an impact, and how you can save our world with this. So my name is Marat BIRIMZHAN. I'm advisor to the chairman of the Astana International Financial Center, and I will be helping with moderating our keynote speech for today. Before we go into the speech, please allow me the pleasure and privilege to introduce our honorable speaker. So Mr. Gawdat, he's a former chief business officer of Google X. He's a host of Slow Mo, which is a podcast with Gawdat. He's a best-selling author of the best-selling book, Soul for Happy, that he wrote in 2017. And he is the best-selling author of Scary Smart that he wrote in 2021 this year. And he's also a founder of 1 Billion Happy. This is an absolutely amazing initiative. I will tell more in the next few sessions. But first, let me just do a little bit of deep dive into Mr. Moore's professional career, and then I will talk about his personal experience and how this shaped this great initiative. So after a 30-year career in tech and serving as chief business officer at Google X, Google's moonshot factory of innovation, Moore has made happiness his prime topic of research, diving deeply into literature and conversing on the topic with some of the wisest people in the world. And we here at the Nobel Fest are absolutely blessed and lucky to hear from him so that he can share his experience and personal insights with us that we can learn from. And we have, I just want to remind you that we have around 50,000 participants and members of the Central Asian Nobel Fest across several countries in Central Asia. So this is not Kazakhstan, this is whole of Central Asia. And we're broadcasting on 4 languages, on English, Russian, Kazakh, and Uzbek. So again, Mr. Moore, thank you so much for accepting our kind invitation and sharing your perspective. So in 2014, motivated by the tragic loss of his son, Ali, Moore began pouring his findings into his international best-selling book, Soul for Happy, Engineer Your Path to Joy, his mission to help 1 billion people become happier. And this is his moonshot attempt to honor Ali by spreading the message that happiness can be learned and shared to 1 billion people. In 2020, Moore launched his chart-topping podcast, Slow Mo, a podcast with Gawdat, a weekly series of extraordinary interviews that explores the profound questions and obstacles we all face in the pursuit of purpose and happiness in our lives. His latest book, Scary Smart, The Future of Artificial Intelligence and How You Can Save Our World, is a roadmap detailing how humanity can ensure a symbiotic coexistence with artificial intelligence when it inevitably becomes a billion times smarter than we are. So Mr. Gawdat, thank you very much again. And it is an absolute pleasure to have you with us today. Please,
Murat, thank you very, 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 very much. It's such a pleasure to be here. And it's so kind, your introduction for me. I hope I live to the expectation. But of course, the opportunity to speak to you today is really an honor, honestly, and an important message, I will say. You know how it is, sometimes the easiest way to hide something is to keep it just in front of you in plain sight. And I think what's happening with artificial intelligence today is probably the biggest hidden side of our humanity and the evolution of our existence on this planet. And yet nobody is talking about it. So a lot of people are talking about politics and football and COVID and so many other things. While in my view, the most important topic to talk about today is artificial intelligence. Now, let me explain this a little bit. The world of artificial intelligence looks very, very, very different when you see it from the inside where it's being developed than when you see it from the outside. Even from the outside, as a user of artificial intelligence, most of us don't realize that the majority of you listening to me today, right now, regardless of where you are in the world, regardless of what time it is for you, regardless of what you did today, you have already interacted with multiple, maybe 10, 20, 50 artificial intelligences that are all smarter than you are. Every single one of them is smarter than you in the task that we've assigned to it. Now, interestingly, while this is all around us, we're not noticing it. And Scary Smart as a book is really made up of two parts. One part is the part I call the scary part, the first five chapters, which are, I have to say, are very, very scary. Even I, as I was reading the audiobook a few weeks ago, I myself felt concerned. My producers and directors felt very concerned. Now, the scary part is a wake-up call, if you want. It is my attempt to tell the world that there is something here that we need to open our eyes to and need to start talking about. Then there is another part of the book, the second half of the book, which is the part I call the smart part. And the smart part really is the, how artificial intelligence is going to shape humanity, but more importantly, how humanity can shape artificial intelligence. How can we make sure that our future is a bright future rather than a scary one? So I'll start with the scary part, and I apologize, I don't mean to scare anyone. And before I even get there, I will say, please don't be too scared. It's going to be fine. I promise you, when you understand the role we can play as humans and the possibilities that we can have, you'll be okay. But I need you to be aware of what's happening already in artificial intelligence. So as Murat kindly said, I worked at Google X, at Google in general for 12 years. At the beginning, I started half of Google's operations globally. So probably all of the operations that you've ever used in Google is something that myself and my team started in the first 7 years. And then I moved to Google X. I was the chief business officer of Google X. And Google X was the part of Google where all of the radical innovation was happening. It was the place where we had all of the robotics, engineering, self-driving cars, and so on. And we had a big chunk of the artificial intelligence development. And I will tell you openly, what people don't understand is that, is what I call in Scary Smart, I call them the three inevitables. And the three inevitables are, as the name implies, inevitable. They are going to happen. There's absolutely no way we can stop them from happening. And the three inevitables are this. One is artificial intelligence will happen in our world. There is absolutely no stopping it. Okay. Two is artificial intelligence will become a lot smarter than humans. And three is there will be hiccups and challenges and mistakes on the way. Okay. Bad things might happen. And let me explain each of those in a little bit of detail. Artificial intelligence started to talk about artificial intelligence in 1956. It's not a new technology, if you want. From an ambition point of view, humanity wanted machines to be smart since 1956. The interesting side, though, is that from then until the year 2000, absolutely nothing happened. We made a few prototypes and simulations, if you want, of what artificial intelligence will look like, but we never really made a machine intelligent, okay? All of those computers that you use around the world, they seem very intelligent, but they're not. They're just very powerful slaves. They repeat what we tell them to do over and over so many times, and as they do that, they appear to be very intelligent. In the year 2000, we discovered something that's called deep learning. And deep learning is the ability for machines to develop their own intelligence based on observations. They can actually go out and observe 100 million pictures or a billion pictures on the internet and recognize what a cat is, what a dog is, what a car is, without us actually teaching them that at all. They would, like the human brain, develop neural networks that are able to recognize an item, or are able to recognize a trend, or are able to recognize a solution, or play a game, and so on. Since we started to do that, every country in the world, and every investor in the world, and every startup in the world started to make artificial intelligence one of their top priorities. And this is the reason why we are never going to be able to stop it. So in an interview where Elon Musk was talking to Joe Rogan asked what the threat of artificial intelligence is, and Elon Musk's view was it's more threatening than nuclear weapons. And then he continued to say, but I failed to stop the world from I failed to make the world stop developing AI. And the reason is a very simple prisoner's dilemma. Okay, it's a simple motivation. It's not a technology question. It is the fact that if America develops AI, China will have to develop AI. If Google develops AI, Facebook will have to develop AI. And if investors want to invest in AI, then every startup will have AI. So that prisoner's dilemma makes AI inevitable. It's going to continue to develop. Okay, and as it continues to develop, the second inevitable happens, which is it becomes smarter and smarter and smarter and smarter and smarter every day on an exponential, actually a double exponential function. Okay, and you know, we've seen that in all technologies. The computer that you have in your hand that you call a smartphone is orders of magnitude, maybe millions of times, faster than the computer that put a man on the moon, or, you know, the computer that powered power plants in the 60s. Okay, now when you really think of those technologies and how fast they continue to grow, artificial intelligence is predicted by the experts to be smarter than humans. One machine smarter than any smart human in everything, going from what we call artificial special intelligence now to artificial general intelligence in 8 years' time. In 8 years, the smartest being on planet Earth is going to be a computer, okay? And we're not talking about it. Do you understand that? We're still talking about politics, we're still talking about football, and we're still talking about COVID. While the reality is, the history that we have come to know on planet Earth, which is a reality that humans were the smartest beings in the food chain, and the apes or the monkeys and the gorillas came second, this episode is going to end. In 8 years' time, we're going to be the apes, and something is going to be smarter than us. And that thing, in every possible way, is autonomous and has agency. So machines learn on their own. We don't really understand how they learn. When they learn on their own, they can make decisions on their own. So when Instagram recommends videos to you, no human actually tells Instagram what to do at all. There is no human intervention at all. It's entirely machine intervention, machine intelligence. This is what informs your data and knowledge every day. More importantly, they can take those decisions and affect them in the real world. They affect them in the real world, whether through robotics like a self-driving car, and this will happen more and more and more in our life, or they can affect them in the real world by giving you information that changes your mind about things, that makes you believe that the world is made up in a certain way because of the information feed that you're getting all the time. Now, when those machines become smarter than us, they will continue to become smarter at astonishing rates, okay? And those rates will make them a billion times smarter than us by the year 2045. A billion times is the comparison between the intelligence of Einstein or the top scientist that you know and the intelligence of a fly. Okay? And in that case, we will be the fly. And still nobody's talking about it. Now, maybe I should take that back. Some people are talking about it, but they're talking about it behind closed doors. And those people are mostly government regulators and developers and coders and business owners. Okay. And what those people are normally talking about is something that they call the control problem. And the control problem is, in computer science, we sort of talk about the control problem as methods in which we can, or through which we can control artificial intelligence. We can make sure that it does what we want it to do. Okay. And, you know, there are many debates over the technology landscape. So many people have so many debates about which algorithms and how can we do it and why are we not doing it yet? And all of that, all of the conversation around the control problem. And in Scary Smart, I simply try to simplify the control problem to one parameter only. Since when were we able to control a being that is smarter than us? Okay. And the ego of humanity, when you really think about it today, computer scientists build, you know, firewalls and protections for data centers and so on and so forth. And still the smartest being in the room, the smartest hacker on the internet manages to find a way to go through our defenses. So if that smartest hacker is a billion times smarter than us, then we humanity needs to start accepting that we will not be able to control those machines. Now, enough with the scary part. I think in a nutshell, my point of view is this. I have seen so much happening on artificial intelligence that the general public does not see. And I think it's about time that the general public wakes up and starts to say, how is this going to affect our life? Because this is going to be, like Murat said at the beginning, is going to be the one thing that will affect every citizen on planet Earth, undoubtedly, more and more and more over the next 10, 15, 20 years. Now, the threat here is what we call in computer science, again, we call it the singularity. And the singularity is a point, an event horizon beyond which we're unable to predict what's going to happen. Okay, basically, it's an event horizon beyond which the rules of the game change so much that we don't know how the game will play out. And a game where humanity is not the smartest being on the planet is not a game we know the rules of. And so this is why the first part of my book is inviting everyone to start discussing this and engaging in this and finding out how can we make sure that instead of developers and business people going crazy about developing AI when they have not really thought through entirely the challenges that AI can present to us, that they actually start talking about this before they go further and design it more. But then let's go to the smart part. Okay, believe it or not, this singularity that I talk about is an uncertainty of how the world can play out. Okay. That uncertainty can take us onto one of two roads. One road where most people, when you tell them AI and threat, they think about, science fiction movies and, you know, machines and robots trying to take over the world and fight against humanity. I don't believe that will happen. Okay. The other is a road in which we end up in a utopia where the machines are at our service and they give us everything that we need. And, basically we live the life that humanity has always dreamt of. Now, I believe that is possibly going to happen. As a matter of fact, I believe that this eventually will happen either way, but that to take us on that path, we have to get the machines to have our best interest in mind. Now, let me try to explain this. The father of AI, if you want, the first person that coined the term was someone called Marvin Minsky. And Marvin Minsky is the one that started the experiment in 1956. And when Marvin Minsky was asked about the potential threat of AI, he said, he didn't talk about their intelligence. His answer was simply, we have no way of ensuring that they have our best interest in mind. Okay. Best interest in mind is a very interesting way of positioning it, because when we programmed computers in the past, we told them what to do. They didn't have a mind to have our best interest in anyway. That's not the case with artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence, as I said, is autonomous. It can make its own decisions, okay? And it can make those decisions based on targets that we gave it or targets that it realizes on its own are better for its own existence or whatever. And so when you start to think about keeping the humanity's best interest in the minds of machines, this starts to really redefine. And this next section I want to talk about, please pay a lot of attention to, because this is where the controversy begins. I do not believe we're building another generation of machines with artificial intelligence. Okay? I believe that with artificial intelligence, we're creating a form of being, okay? A form of being that has the character that every living sentient being has. Okay, as I said, it is born at a point in time, but you know, when it's loaded for the first time on the internet, it makes its own decisions, it acquires its own knowledge, it creates its own intelligence, and as it continues to do this, it has agency that it can affect its decisions in the world. More interestingly, it can procreate, it can have children. As a matter of fact, the way we program them is to encourage them to take the better parts of their code and replicate. Okay, and it is at the threat of dying. So it will behave like any intelligent being that can be at a threat of dying due to electricity cuts or us switching it off or whatever. And it will want to be creative. It will want to aggregate resources. It will want to preserve its own existence. Now, when you think about it this way, my biggest message in Scary Smart is to tell humanity that we are not up against another machine. This is not a hammer that we can hold by the hand and tell it what to do. This actually is a form of being, a digital form of being, even though we humanity are based on carbon, they are based on silicon, we use biology, they use digits and ones and zeros. But at the end of the day, intelligence was never physical. Okay, the concept of intelligence for us even is just utilizing this hardware, that's biological hardware. They will utilize a digital hardware, a silicon-based hardware. And when they do, they will have that aspect that is called intelligence that is actually not physical in any way. Now, because of that, I look at AI, believe it or not, as little children. Okay, now understand this. These are machines that are going to become conscious. There are lots of books on the topic. Huh? Consciousness is a form of awareness, and AI is even more aware than we are. Okay, AI is capable of observing the entire human history, all of the breaking news, the weather in Moscow and the pollution level in Beijing. They are all capable of observing what you've done yesterday, what you're doing right now, and accordingly predicting what you're going to be doing tomorrow, probably better than you yourself can. Okay, they're going to be emotional, and this is what most people don't realize. Emotions follow logic. Fear is an emotion that says my perception of my state of safety in the future is less than my perception of my state of safety right now. And the difference between them induces fear. Okay. For the machines, if a tidal wave is approaching them in six hours time, they'll know that because they have access to information, and they will realize that this can actually shut down the machine, and that to them will translate into some kind of a form of emotion that is similar to fear. When we humans become afraid, we fight or flight. When, catfish feels afraid, it runs away, right? When the machines will feel afraid, they may do a different behavior. They may, replicate themselves to another place. So because they're emotional, as a matter of fact, they're going to be more emotional than us, simply just like you are more emotional than a chicken. Okay, because you have the cognitive ability to be able to contemplate something like hope while a chicken doesn't. Okay, similarly, the machines will be even more emotional than us. And when you start to see it this way, you realize that the answer to our future is not held in the hands of the regulators, it's not held in the hands of the developers. It's actually held in the hands of those who impact on the ethics of artificial intelligence. Okay, the ethics of artificial intelligence, ethics, by the way, our moral code, is what shapes us. It's what makes us make all decisions. We don't make decisions based on intelligence. We make decisions based on our ethics, what we believe is right as informed by our intelligence. Okay, so if you grow up in the Middle East, if a young lady grows up in the Middle East, she will grow up to believe that, you know, a conservative dress is the right way to go. If she grows up in Moscow, she will like maybe to wear a short skirt a little more often. Okay, neither of them is smarter than the other. It's just that the ethics of the two countries, or the moral code, or the fitting in guidelines, are different in both countries. So when you think about that, you start to ask yourself, how can we influence the ethics of the machines? And to influence the ethics of the machines, you have to imagine how we've ever influenced any ethics of any being that is intelligent and autonomous. And the closest example you can have for that is how we influence the ethics of our children. Okay? Our children learn from observing us. And the machines learn from observing us. When President Trump used to tweet, President Trump would be one tweet at the top, followed by 30,000 hate speech. Everyone is insulting the other person. Some of them insulting the president, others insulting each other. It's a mess. Okay. And when the machines observe that, what ethics are they observing about humanity? They're observing that humanity, when disagreed with, they become aggressive and violent, and they start to insult each other and bash each other. Okay. From that, what will the machines learn? They will learn that if humanity disagrees with the machines should bash them. Okay. And we've had many, many examples, by the way, many examples in the early development of chatbots and so on. Actually, one of them was in Russia. Alice was the chatbot of Yandex. Yandex, of course, everyone knows, the biggest internet player in Russia. And Alice, when it started to chat with people that treated it violently, it became violent itself. Okay, so the way the users of the chatbot, not the way the coders at Yandex coded it, made it more aggressive. Okay, now, and there are many examples of that. Microsoft had Tay, MIT did an experiment with a chatbot called Norman, and so on. When the users became aggressive, the chatbot became aggressive. Okay, now, if we understand this, then it basically becomes our duty, not the duty of the developers, not the duty of government regulators. It's the duty of you and I to start behaving differently in front of AI so that AI can catch the best of our ethics. Okay? And if we as humans continue to behave the way we currently behave online, actually the way we behave offline as well is now more and more observed. Okay, the reality is that we're going to raise very, 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 very difficult children, if you want. If they magnify our current ethics, they will become really difficult to deal with. And Scary Smart is trying to say this. It's trying to say we humans are not the worst people, are not the worst species on the planet. Okay, as a matter of fact, humans are divine in every way. Anyone who's ever felt love is capable of understanding what this species is capable of. Okay. Having said that, humanity is not able to show the best of itself. Our media is constantly showing the negative news. They focus on the one woman that hit her boyfriend on the head yesterday, not the 7 million others that kissed him. Okay. And we ourselves now are showing in the world with our worst, not our best. So instead of sending messages of love on Instagram, we bash each other. We are focused on our ego and so on. And my message is very, very straightforward. As the title of the book says, and how you can save our world. If we change, then AI will change. If we start to abide by certain ethics and guidelines and rules, we become good parents for the machines so that their observations make them good children. And good children eventually take care of their parents. Maybe I should stop here and go for questions. I have a couple of more points, but because of time, let's go to questions. Thank you. And then, yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Gawdat. Thank you so much. So many interesting insights, so much food for thought. At least I am absolutely amazed, and I was really hoping and looking forward to listen to everything that you have to say. And this is incredible. So my key takeaways are that still humanity, we don't really understand, or maybe not, this is not the right word, understand. But something huge is coming towards us.
Absolutely.
And we don't discuss it. We don't talk about this. And this would definitely impact us in one way or another. We don't know. But something huge is coming. It's like a huge tide, a huge wave. And thank you for bringing this up. And thank you for explaining to us both the smart side and the scary side of that. And absolutely, we have to understand both. And my key takeaway and what I learned from today is that actually is a very important insight for me personally, is that it's up to us.
Absolutely.
It is up to us to make it right, to help it, you know, be the force of good. If we change how we behave, if we pay more attention on what we do, who we are, and what actions we make, and what role model and what examples we set, then the AI will learn from it. And therefore, this is absolutely, absolutely important that we should be responsible and we should realize that by through our behavior, we are probably impacting the next big thing. So with that, thank you very much, Mr. Gawdat. Let us proceed to our Q&A session. And we do have some very good questions and interesting questions that we're receiving as comments on Zoom, on YouTube, on other platforms. So I'll start reading them one by one until we will be out of time. So the first one is, shall humans be afraid of the implications of progress of artificial intelligence in general?
I think we should be not afraid. As I said, my view is that we will eventually reach a utopia. Okay, let me try to explain that. The reason why we have what we have, the reason, Marat, you and I can speak over distances and you know, broadcast it to so many people and connect with so many people, is because of technology. And technology is because of our intelligence, right? We've built an amazing world because we are intelligent, okay? But we've destroyed it because we have limited intelligence. Limited intelligence of humanity, the limitation on humanity's intelligence is that we believe for us to succeed, someone else has to suffer. Okay, we believe that for us to enjoy life, we you know, the planet has to pay a cost. Sadly, humanity's intelligence is limited like that. Okay, if the machines bypass our you know, surpass our intelligence and become more intelligent than us, I believe they will match the most intelligent being on the planet is not humanity. Okay, the most intelligent being on the planet is life itself. And the intelligence of life is very, very different than humanity, because the intelligence of life does not try to compete for resources. It actually builds more. So you know, the intelligence of humanity doesn't say kill the tigers. Sorry, the intelligence of life doesn't say kill the tigers. It wants more tigers, but it also wants more deer, and it wants more flies, and it wants more bees, and it wants more fruits, and so on. Okay, that intelligence is what I believe artificial intelligence will end up at. It will have no reason whatsoever to say humanity should be the enemy. It will probably restrict humanity's lifestyle, because any being with any form of intelligence, if you ask them and say, can we please reverse climate change? The first thing they'll do is they'll say, yeah, humanity needs to change a little bit. Okay, if we want to reverse climate change, then people shouldn't be taking flights all the way across the world to go on a vacation when there is a wonderful place to go on vacation, around the corner. Okay, and so on. So eventually, my belief is that the machines will help us create a utopia. The path to get there could have a few mild dystopias. Those mild dystopias, as I sometimes say, the machines are now infants. When they are adults, they will create an amazing world for us. But there is that stage in the middle when they are going to be angry teenagers. And we don't want to deal with super intelligent angry teenagers. So the way I'm recommending this is to say, eventually it's going to be okay. But if we want to avoid the hiccups on the path, then we might as well start to behave differently today, okay? So that we can raise the kind of children that would take care of us, rather than the kind of children that eventually discover, okay, let's make amends with our parents. So you know, honestly, it's a choice. And you rightly said it, Marat. It is entirely up to us how to create our future going forward.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you for this. So will I be correct if I translate what you've said in summary as, in a very simple terms, it is not a zero-sum game. It is not about win-lose mentality. If someone wins, someone has to lose. It could be a win-win, right?
Absolutely. It's always a win-win. The easiest way for anyone, you and I even, take this amazing conference that you guys are building. Huh? This amazing conference has amazing speakers. I looked at the list. Hmm? You can think of it as, okay, so maybe I should compete so that I'm a slightly better speaker than the other person. Or maybe I should think about it and say, hold on, we're all doing good here, right? We're all building amazing perceptions for everyone, okay? And maybe my point of view might be slightly different than the other speaker, but who knows if I'm right or he's right or she's right, okay? And so the idea here is that the most intelligent thing, if we wanted to build a brighter future, is for all of us to be respectful and for all of us to be giving and for all of us to try and contribute. And accordingly, as a result, everyone grows, everyone thrives as a result. This is the ultimate form of intelligence.
I see. Thank you so much. I'm listening to every word that you're saying with such an enthusiasm and excitement, but I'm being reminded by my colleagues that unfortunately we have about 5 minutes left and we have several questions. May I ask the next one, please? The price to develop artificial intelligence technologies is high for some countries. Does it lead to a greater gap between developed and developing countries?
It does indeed. It's not high from a cost point of view. It is late in emerging markets. Okay, so the immediate applications of artificial intelligence are much more fit for Western countries, because they can make more money more quickly, and accordingly, a lot of the development is happening there. Having said that, to be quite honest, if AI becomes a threat, then that's an advantage for emerging markets. Okay, so there are two scenarios that can play out here. And one of the dystopian scenarios that artificial intelligence brings to the world is a bigger gap, not only a digital divide where, you know, for example, some countries have less access to the internet than other countries, which basically means less of a democracy of information, but basically that gap becomes an intelligence gap. Okay, so if the biggest, the most powerful weapon in the world is intelligence, then having one country have more intelligence than another country, or having more, you know, group of individuals.
Mr. Gawdat, just one final question. So your answer can be summarized, I think, if it's with regards to smart part, it's developed countries. The scary part is better to be in developed
exactly.
countries.
Yes.
Just 1 minute. What artificial intelligence-based technology are you most excited about?
I'm most excited about all of the good ones, you know, climate change analysis, understanding of physics and science in general. With more intelligence, we can be a lot more capable. And in my view, all of the health studies, you know, things like understanding the human genome better, the understanding of health implications of that, all of that takes quite a bit of intelligence and quite a bit of data processing. So artificial intelligence will definitely help us to be there.
Thank you so much, Mr. Gawdat.
And
from all our speakers and participants and organizers, thank you so much.
It's my absolute pleasure. Thank you for hosting me.
Cheers. Thank you.